Hello and welcome to this new episode of Free Science 365. Today we are going to talk about Japanese bullet train. What makes a bullet train a bullet train? The fastest train in the world since 1964. Interestingly, bullet trains started in October of 1964, the same month as now. Today, we are going to talk in detail about what makes a bullet train a bullet train. I found 10 factors, 5 technical factors and 5 human factors. So we'll talk about technical factors. Technically speaking, if you, for example, take a normal train and if you make 5 changes in it, you will end up with a bullet train. Of course, technically speaking, that's true, because when you implement technology in a different context and different culture with different people, the results are always different. So bear in mind that difference. So the 5 technical factors. First, a bullet train usually has about 16 compartments or carriages or cars. On either side, the driver's compartment, and in between you have 14 compartments. So I have a question. Where do you think is the engine of the bullet train? Is it in the front, or is it in the back driving compartment, or is it somewhere in between? The answer is it's neither in the front, nor in the back, nor in the middle. Each of the compartments of the train have their own motors. So each compartment has 2 motors, and that is 28 different motors. So it's not the same as your everyday train, where you have only one compartment or one engine, either in the front or in the back. In case of bullet train, every single car, every single carriage compartment is in itself having a motor that drives the car. So that's difference number one. But why? Well, because what we are talking here is speed. And how do you make a train go at an extremely high speed? You give each car its own power. Each car with its 2 motors pulling at the same time by adjusting their timing, synchronizing these motors together. You can have a lot of force to drive these heavy carriages together. At the same time, it also makes it very easy, comparably, to stop. Because then you apply brakes on all these 28 motors, and if you do it in synchronization, you can stop much more efficiently without disturbing the passengers, because each passenger experiences the braking of only their carriage. So that's difference number one. Let's focus on wheels now. The shape of the wheel is very, very important. Why? Well, if you have a flat wheel, what happens is when you're turning, it's not able to turn very properly. So what is the alternative to a flat wheel? You have the wheels a little bit conical in shape. It helps the train not derailing, but the wheels move a little side to side as well. So they not only go straight, but also there's a little oscillation, there's a little movement from side to side. So the wheels are not going straight like this, rather they're going straight like this. When you have a very high powered train going with this kind of movement along the straight rails, they end up making the rails dysfunctional. They change the shapes of the rails and make them dysfunctional. This phenomenon had been observed many times in the past. And this effect is called the hunting problem. And the faster you go, the more observable is the hunting effect. Now, when the engineers were thinking about driving the trains at the speeds of 300 plus kilometers an hour, of course, they knew that hunting will become a problem. So what did they do? Japanese engineers came to a compromise. They didn't want the wheels to be very flat. They didn't want it to be angled as much as it is in a normal train. So they found this shape. So this shape, if you look at, is not very much angled, not as angled as a normal train, but it's also not the flattest out there. So that's the second difference. Now, the third factor. Trains sometimes take very strong curves. Sometimes the trains have to do that. And in case the train is going at a high speed of 300 kilometers an hour, if you have to take a sharp curve for whatever reason, you are risking derailment, and that's dangerous. And this is what we call the banking problem. So what do you do? Now, if you have observed a motorcycle racer, you will notice that when they are taking sharp turns, they also turn their body towards the curve. Now, on a bullet train, when the train would take a curve, a sharp curve, you risk a lot of discomfort to the passengers who are paid a lot of money to enjoy the trip. So what do? In each compartment, you have an airbag, and this airbag is full of air, but how much air goes what way is controlled by a computer. So a computer system controls, for example, if the train is going to take this curve, the air goes from this side to this side, giving more weight to this side, hence making it easy to bank without discomforting the passengers. So that's the third big difference. Without compromising the speed, they found this amazing solution to make banking as easy as possible. Okay, so far we have discussed three things: individual motor system, hunting problem solved, banking problem solved. The fourth difference. All the electrical vehicles that you encounter in your everyday life, metro trains, subways, trams, they all have a pantograph. It transfers the power from the wires, electrical wires up there, on to the motor of the train. But there's a difference between the way the bullet trains have built their pantographs and the normal pantographs that you have. You might have observed, sometimes when the trains are going at a very high speed, you can see the pantographs creating some sparks on the wires. Why do we have these sparks? What happens is the pantograph is not always able to make a continuous contact with the wires up there. So sometimes, because of the air, the wind, the speed of the train, and other factors, what happens is sometimes there is a small disconnection between the pantograph and the electrical wires. And so this small gap in the contact, what it does is the air in that gap becomes plasma. And plasma, as you know, is very high temperature thing. It ionizes the air in that area. And if you want to know more about this plasma thing, you can watch one of my previous videos here. This plasma spark can create big problems when you're driving the train at 300 kilometers an hour. It doesn't create much problem in trains that drive at, let's say, 40 to 50 kilometers an hour, which is the case with the metros and the subways and the trams. But at high speeds, the stakes also are very, very high. And so that becomes a problem. So what do we do so that there's never a breakage in the connection? There's no discontinuity. The pantograph never breaks away from the wires up there. So what the engineers came up with was a compensation mechanism, a feedback system, a kind of a lever system. You can avoid this plasmization, changing the air into plasma, these sparks, which can be lethal, which can be potentially very, very dangerous. You can avoid these dangerous, potentially dangerous plasma sparks by making the pantograph never leave the electrical wires. And that's exactly what the engineers did. They supplied a feedback mechanism, so a spring system works. And so what happens is the pantograph always pulls up. It applies an upward force on the electrical wires. And if the electrical wires, for whatever reason, wind or speed or any other reason, if the electrical wires try to push down on the pantograph doesn't resist it. Actually, it just pushes down because of the way it is constructed. And you'll be surprised to know there's 25,000 volts of electricity flowing down these pantographs to the electrical motors. So that's a lot of voltage. On a normal train, the electrical supply is about 800 volts. It varies between 700 volts and 1,000 volts, but let's take on an average 800 volts. Even at 800 volts, you can see these plasma sparks on the pantograph and the wire connection. Now imagine the quantity, the amount of ionization of air when the pantograph, instead of supplying 800 volts, it's supplying 25,000 volts. That is how much bigger? 30 times. So 30 times bigger voltage can create at least 30 times bigger plasma sparks, And these plasma sparks, 30 times bigger plasma sparks, would be big enough to destroy the electrical wires, and they increase the chance of the train compartments catching fire. So that is very, very dangerous. So at 25,000 volts, the train running at 300 km an hour, you can't afford even a microsecond of disconnection between the pantograph and the electrical wires up there. So that's why they needed a system, a pantograph, we can say the perfect pantograph, and they did it. They built it using their ingenuity. And that's the fourth big difference between a normal electrical vehicle, electrical train, and a bullet train. Now comes the fifth. So if you look at the front of a normal train, you see a boxy thing. But the front of a bullet train, as you can see here, is not a box. Now this shape is very unique. But the question arises, why do we need this shape? If you look at the first bullet trains that were unveiled in 1964, their front, they actually looked like a proper bullet, like a gun bullet. But very soon, engineers realized a big problem. So what happened is, as you know, Japan is a very mountainous country, and so when they built these bullet train tracks, they had to cut through a lot of mountains. So the bullet trains would go through a lot of tunnels. Now what's the problem there? Well, the problem is, with the design that we had initially in 1964, it didn't allow the air, because when you're going inside a tunnel at 300 km an hour, what happens is, the air that was in the tunnel has no way to escape because of the shape of the bullet train. And so the air is also pushed at a very, very high speed. And what it does is it creates a sonic boom, a sonic blast. So as soon as the train enters one end of the tunnel, the other side of the tunnel would ooze out a lot of very dangerous waves coming out at a very dangerous speed. So this sonic boom, this sonic disturbance was extremely dangerous. And engineers had to do something about it. So they realized that the best shape to cut through the air without creating this sonic problem is to make the face of the train similar to the beak of a kingfisher. The kingfisher's beak is very unique, and it allows for optimum braking of the air or water in a very streamlined way. And that's exactly what the engineers wanted for the trains to do. They wanted the trains to brake, pierce through the air, allowing it to escape not only in the front but also in the back. And so when you see the front of a bullet train, that's the beak of a kingfisher. So these are the five technical differences between a normal electric train and a bullet train. If you like it, please share it. If you haven't subscribed yet, please do subscribe. And as always, I'll see you in the next one. Until then, bye-bye.